Great. Thanks for having me here today. I'd like to talk about a couple of issues regarding cyber war. I've been pretty skeptical about cyber war for a number of years, and people don't seem to understand why. And it's been extremely puzzling for me to try to get people to realize that when cyber war is being sold as a problem, that it's actually several problems that are being sold as a unit, and those are actually not problems that work together as a unit. So what I'd like to do is deconstruct the components of those problems into focus areas, talk about those a little bit, examine the properties of attack and defense in each of those focus areas, and then talk about some of the possible overlaps and non-synergies in those focus areas, and then we can talk about how you might actually defend yourself against those and what the implications of that are. And one of the problems when you start talking about cyber war as a domain of warfare or another new area of warfare is there are some of the laws of warfare that apply. Like, you do have to have a strategy. So warfare is generally conducted in the scope of some kind of a grand strategic plan, and you have to have tactics. And in some cases, those do apply in cyberspace, and in other cases, they don't. One of the things that really bugs me a lot about cyberspace, for example, is there is no high ground in cyberspace. There is, in fact, no terrain in cyberspace. If you want to try to analogize warfare into cyberspace, cyberspace is a place where your enemy can create all the terrain that they want, and then they can either choose to hold it or not hold it, or they can choose to attack you from it or not attack you from it. They can appear and disappear. The ideas of trying to do a spoiling attack or defending the high ground or any of this kind of stuff really don't apply. But some aspects of the military art do. For example, logistics is still important in cyberspace. I don't want to get ahead of myself, so let's get into this. Okay, the first of these focus areas would be the cyber criminal. The cyber criminal's agenda is, I call it diffuse, it's profit driven. They just want to make some money. What they want to do is they want to make 25 cents from a million people or $25 from a million people. It doesn't really matter. They're all about the money. They're entirely tactical. It's short term. They really don't care. If they can make a pile of money today, well, they'll try to do it again tomorrow. But they don't have some kind of, you know, strategic plan to destroy your economy. They're really worried about their own economy, and they don't care where they're going. They're going to go after the sweetest, fattest, easiest target, some kind of a combination factor of all of those different things. So the threat is this kind of profitable hit-and-run attack, and you're never going to be able to eradicate them. Why are you never going to be able to eradicate them? Because there's no central organization. They're organic. Trying to eradicate cyber criminals is like trying to eradicate bacteria. It's a foolish concept. In fact, if you eradicated all of the cyber criminals somehow by snapping your finger, there'd be a whole bunch of guys going, "Wow, this is great. We now have no competition. Let's go into the cyber criminal business because it's an open field right now." Right? So that's a problem. They're going to always be creative, and they're going to always shift to where the money is. Now, the next one is a completely different one, cyber spies. We hear a great deal of talk from Washington about, you know, there's this cyber war going on, and then espionage kind of gets blended into it as if it's part of the same thing. But it's actually not the same thing. The purpose of a spy is to surreptitiously gather information from a target, suborn and manage trusted agents in place to try to establish a strategic long-term position inside the enemy's information infrastructure or inside their decision loops. The reason you want to do that is, one, so you can tell what the enemy is doing, two, so that you may be able to fool them or control their decision loops, or three, so that you can find out useful technical information about whatever, you know, fun stuff it is that the enemy's building that they plan to use on you. The point about cyber espionage, though, is that it is only done in a strategic context. You're not going to be a cyber spy against the entire world. You're going to be a cyber spy against the people in the world who have stuff that's interesting, or the people in the world who are directly, most likely to be direct threats to you. So I would be willing to guess, for example, that the U.S. probably is not engaged in a particularly significant cyber espionage initiative against the government of Liechtenstein at this point. Right? I think they make dentures or something like that is the primary export of Liechtenstein. We've probably got that covered, so there's not going to be a great deal of espionage there. The point is, it's a strategic activity. It's not something someone is going to engage in randomly as part of one of these diffuse efforts. Or if they are doing it diffusely, they're doing something very expensive in an extremely pointless way. Right? So from a threat standpoint, some aspects of the cyber arena really simplify things for a spy, right? You don't have to mess around with all those micro dots anymore. Sure, you can, you know, post an encrypted message on Facebook or something like that and do some steganography. So it simplified some things. But the core espionage problem of identifying your target, figuring out what assets they've got, figuring out how to acquire those assets, and figuring out how to exfiltrate those assets. If you think about it, exfiltrating the assets is probably the least significant of those problems. So it doesn't change things a whole lot. And of course, we hear about the cyber terrorists. We're all, you know, really scared about the cyber terrorists. Or some of us appear to be really scared about the cyber terrorists. What are the terrorists trying to do? The mythical cyber terrorist is trying to do ideological maximum damage strikes. But again, it's a diffuse thing. More importantly, it's a tactical thing. The cyber terrorist may have, or the terrorist may have, a grand strategic vision, like, you know, roll back Western civilization or something like that, if you're, you know, Ted Kaczynski. But in order to do that, what they're going to do is they're going to try to do operations that are going to make sense in that sort of grand strategic concept, but it's not going to be generally a published grand strategic concept, because if you do, you wind up getting arrested pretty quickly. So usually what you wind up having is these kind of ideologically oriented shots out of the blue, which, because they're organized in a diffuse manner with a matrix structure at best, there's no kind of orderly command hierarchy that you can launch severance attacks against. It's very, very difficult to deal with. It's very, very difficult to deal with terrorism. You contrast that with espionage, and you can immediately see that these are completely different activities, right? Because espionage, you've got spy masters that are working for governments, and you can roll up a spy ring, and you can say, yeah, this spy ring belongs to this particular government. They've got this particular agenda. You can paint that entire strategic roadmap, whereas otherwise you might be saying, you know, this group of cyber hackers were planning on reversing the sewers in Dubuque. And, you know, we caught them, right? And what the first time you're going to find out what their agenda was is when they tell you what it is. But the threat from terrorists is they want to do critical infrastructure attacks that are going to result in scary, newsworthy things in order to manipulate the target's political process from the outside by scaring them or costing them money. And then the last of the different domains we're going to talk about is the cyber warrior. Warfare always, by definition, is a strategic activity, right? No government at all engages in wars. Well, I shouldn't say that. Shouldn't engage in wars just for fun. Usually there is some kind of an agenda behind it, which means that there must be a mission that is worth accomplishing or that appears to be worth accomplishing before a nation is going to go to war. Right, so there's a couple of really interesting pieces of information that are hidden inside of that definition. First off, you have to be prepared to penetrate, attack, degrade, infiltrate the enemy's command and control systems, because there is eventually going to be a military operation. There's no grand strategic value in my knocking a country's internet infrastructure off the air preparatory to, you know, launching a cyber war if I'm not actually going to launch a war to exploit it. I mean, other than that I'm just an idiot and I, you know, decide let's crash the Russian cyber infrastructure because I'm having a bad day, there has to be a value proposition for why I would crash a nation's cyber infrastructure. And that value proposition must be some kind of a meaningfully achievable geopolitical agenda. So if I'm going to crash their cyber infrastructure, I have to have the troops, tanks, aircraft, whatever, to be able to exploit that, or economic clout. Whatever it is that I'm going to try to do, I have to have the logistical train in order to make that valuable. Otherwise, you know, I'd be purely psychotic to actually do it. So the cyber warrior is going to be having a completely different agenda from all these other guys, because they're going after these high-value, high-cost targets, which hopefully or presumably are going to be hardened against attack, because the target knows that they're high value. You know, they know that it's the network operations center. Cyber criminal doesn't care if he gets into your network operations center or if he gets into your porn collection. He cares whether there's credit card information there that he can monetize. The cyber warrior has to go after these hardened strategic targets. And the reason that this is crucial is when you're going after hardened strategic targets, the chance of you getting caught while you're trying to surreptitiously penetrate them is going to go up exponentially. If someone tries to break into my porn collection, I probably won't notice it. If someone tries to break into some of my customer files, I will notice it. Well, I hope I will notice it anyway. So The agendas that we're talking about are very, very different. And when people talk about cyber war kind of in the bulk, what they do is they say, well, cyber war, and we all have this perception that we're vulnerable to cyber war because, after all, cyber criminals appear to walk into our systems and steal our credit cards like it's nobody's business, right? They're kicking our butts. And so people go, well, obviously, if the cyber criminals are able to kick our butts so easily, imagine what cyber ninjas would be able to do. Imagine what really trained warriors would be able to do. But the point I'm trying to make is that what the trained warriors would be able to do is pretty much exactly what the same thing as the criminals would be able to do. They would just be doing it in a strategic context. And doing it in a strategic context, you have a completely different cost-benefit analysis, because somebody can go and say, who do these warriors work for? With the criminal, there's none of this question of who do they work for. The criminals work for themselves. Nobody's going to be able to haul somebody up from, you know, the Russian business network and haul up Vladimir Putin and say, haul your guys in. He'll say, they're not my guys, right? It's a totally different thing when governments are accusing each other of essentially state-sponsored cyber terror or state-sponsored cyber warfare. Okay, so the agenda of the warriors to penetrate, attack, I already talked about that. Hit the wrong button. Okay, so the agenda is of these different organizations, or these different entities, is misaligned. And if you actually think about it, you'll realize that the activities of the cyber criminal are actually causing the targets to constantly be upgrading their security. If it's just to keep people out of their credit card information, you're still going to have to harden your NOC, because you don't want credit card data stolen out of your NOC if you've got that as well. But what that does is it winds up hardening your strategic infrastructure as well. Right? So the cyber criminals are actually working contrary to the agenda of the cyber warriors by forcing all of those fantastic products that you can see out on the show floor were built largely to prevent cyber crime, but those are also the same products that effectively protect and suppress cyber warfare as well. As we innovate, as the cyber criminals innovate, as the industry innovates in response to them, the cyber warriors' capabilities are being degraded thanks to the activities of the cyber criminals, right? So there's this agenda misalignment. So a couple things jump out at us immediately. The operational needs of cyber criminals and terrorists are isolated. They don't need anybody except for themselves. They don't need a logistic chain, and they don't have to do any kind of follow through. They can get in there, they can cash out, and they can leave. If they fail to cash out, they can get in there and they can leave. It doesn't matter, right? Spies and warriors have a totally different problem. Their operational needs are overlapped because the spies are using the same networks that the warriors are thinking of attacking, so they have to coordinate their operations in order to prevent things from stepping on each other. I'll give you an example of that. Imagine we're in the cyber war room, you know, El Presidente, the corporate guards, everybody's standing around, and I'm the head of the, you know, the cyber war project or something like that, and they say, you know, launch the attack, it's H hour, I click the destroy network button on my my browser interface, and the target's network is taken off a line, and the head of espionage says, great, thanks, you just blinded us, we've got no idea what's going on anymore. We were using their command and control network to see where all of their troops are, and now we don't have that information. You know, and they drag me out of the building, and there's a sound of one shot, and that's it. So this is a problem, right? This has always been a problem in real warfare as well, where we see that the military forces and the spies have to do this coordination dance, you know, like in Coventry during the Second World War, where they have to decide when to give out strategic information for tactical needs and vice versa. So another misalignment scenario. Again, imagine we're in the cyber war room, we're getting ready to launch the war. The generalissimo in charge says, you know, click the destroy button and let's take them down. And I say, sir, I'm really sorry, we can't do that. Well, why not? Well, today's Wednesday. What does that mean? Well, yesterday was Patch Tuesday and Microsoft disabled all of our weapons with a patch. This could happen. I know it sounds ridiculous. And the reason it sounds ridiculous is because it is, right? We're dealing with mythical weapon systems that can be disabled with a single software configuration change done by a junior system administrator. How can you rely on that in a military context? It's a big problem. Another big problem with the cyber war concept is the kinds of defensive strategies that are available. One of the things we hear frequently from people in Washington when they're talking about cyber war is the private sector needs to do more, the government needs to do more, whatever. There's a problem. There is no special super duper internet security stuff that you can't buy on the floor that's out there. In fact, as a, I suppose you could call me a cyber weapons designer, I used to build firewalls and intrusion detection systems and a bunch of stuff like that. If I knew how to build some super duper cool thing that could catch cyber spies, I would sell it immediately to my commercial customers as well. Because if it catches cyber spies, it's going to catch the criminals. It would be a useful general purpose technology. So what's available to us defensive strategies, I put this chart up because it's annoying, is there's really only two things, right? Basic internet security or ask the government to deal with it. Because the reason we pay taxes and the reason we have governments is to engage in grand strategic activities like counterintelligence. A corporation cannot reasonably be expected to do counterintelligence against the Mossad. A government can be reasonably expected to deal with that. I don't know whether they'll do it well, but that's their problem. And so when I hear people from Washington saying that corporate America needs to deal with cyber war better, what I hear is the sound of, we're not doing our job, so we'd like you to do it better for us, because we actually don't really know what we're going to do. So the defensive approach is overlap. And it, you know, so the overlap damages us, but it also helps us. Because again, every time somebody out there, some startup, invents some wonderful new thing in order to catch malware that's trying to exfiltrate credit card information, they may catch the next cyber spy. And that's one of the things I find very fascinating about this, because we are constantly innovating in the computer security community. We are constantly developing new techniques for finding malware. Why is it that all of the cyber espionage that's going on is using exactly the same things as the cyber criminals? Is it possible that the cyber criminals are just trying to steal more information that they can monetize? I don't know. But I would imagine if there was a, you know, super cyber ninja stealth force working for some government, that they would be using tools that would be so good. Except the problem is those tools would be in place and guys like me would find them and publish white papers about them, and then they would be widely known. So one of the things that's fascinating is that the footprints of these cyber spies are basically kind of non-existent, right? They're using lame spear phishing attacks just like the cyber criminals. So there's this overlap of attack and defense where the tools that are available, if the bad guys, if the cyber spies and cyber warriors are using the same tools as the cyber criminals, the stuff that we build to catch the cyber criminals is going to work against them. So they would have to develop whole new application stacks of attack tools and defense tools that, you know, may or may not exist. There might be people who are doing that right now, I don't know. But if they do that and they start fielding it, people like me will start seeing entirely new types of traffic on the network that we've never seen before. So it stands to reason that counterintelligence is really the only place to go. My point at all of this is that there's an insufficient gap between espionage and warfare, and we need to treat the things basically as the same thing because of the logistical problem of trying to field a cyber war capability. It simply doesn't make a great deal of sense. So thank you very much for your time.